everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park, and we're starting a webinar on TA-65 in dogs. And we'll be joined later by Kathy Reinheimer, who has been giving it to her dog, Lulu, who will be this, kind of the star of this show today. So just by way of review, if you don't know, we'll just talk about what is a telomere. Telomere is the end of a chromosome, and all your chromosomes have these ends that shorten as each time a cell divides. If they get too short, they're exposed, and then the cell will join exposed ends, and you end up with a mutation, a double chromosome like this. And if you start trying to separate double chromosomes, you get tears. They just rip apart, and then you get triples and singles and fragments. And this is the final destiny of all cells. What is telomerase? Telomerase is like this old-school label maker. It prints out a message. So this is what they won the Nobel Prize in Medicine for in 2009. This blob is composed of several proteins, TPP, POT, TRF. Anyway, this whole thing is like an engine to print out more telomere. And if the telomeres stay long and protected, we think the stem cells don't age, and therefore you don't get in that trouble that comes with aging. One interesting thing is there's these pine trees called bristlecone pines, or the Pinus longeva. I believe this tree might be called Methuselah, but much older than Methuselah ever got. The tree is estimated to be maybe 5,000 years old, and that's a single organism. And this just bears the point that all living things pretty much require telomeres, and they all require telomerase. And the more telomerase, the longer the organism can live, because the more protected its DNA. All right, so let's just talk evolution for a second here. So it's a matter of O's versus X's. Just think of tic-tac-toe. The X's are kind of the blessing and the problem. So if we look at the so-called tree of life, and this is in rough chronological order from left to right, more or less, but for a while we just had these single-cell organisms of many different types, and they're what we would consider bacteria. There's this off-branching of odd in-betweener kind of organisms. And then the eukarya, which are the eukaryotes. Eukaryotes meaning, I think, good nucleus. So the revolution here was small, single-cell bacteria with a circular DNA. The circular DNA copies itself, no problem, no telomere, because there is no end to a circle. It just starts copying, and it's like two soap bubbles spinning off from one. The problem with being this simple is that you don't get organized. You don't have group behavior, specialization. So what happened in the course of life on Earth was something called symbiogenesis, which means mitochondria were little bacteria that got swallowed up by another organism. And that allowed for plants and animals. Well, the plants, usually the chloroplasts, which are they convert sunlight into energy. Those were swallowed up by plants, or algae, actually, and then the mitochondria by more of the animal things. So what happens when you have an X-shaped DNA? Well, you can have these humongous libraries, and they can be numbering more than just one. You can have, in our case, 23 chromosomes, and they get long, 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 and they just need caps. So you're going from like a fortune cookie to Encyclopedia Britannica. So TERT is telomerase reverse transcriptase. That's that blob, that engine that's pumping out stuff. So this is an article from a while ago. It basically asserts that telomerase act, the subunits that we saw, those little blobs that assemble into a machine, represent a deep branch in evolution, and that reverse transcriptases, which is just means reverse, meaning not DNA to RNA, but RNA to DNA. So that's what the telomerase does. It takes an RNA template and prints out longer DNA. Well, one of the interesting retroviruses that we found out, HIV, is a reverse transcriptase also. It integrates into the DNA by copying from RNA to DNA. But these guys are arguing that maybe they're totally different. It's the same evolutionary adaptation for a different problem. So, you know, like flying squirrels and versus butterflies. They both fly, but about different ways. All right, so let's talk about dog turd versus, that's dog turd with a T, versus H-turd, human turd. So in 2004, this was studied, and it said that the dog turd shows a high level of sequence similarity to human turd, which stands to reason. We're mammals, and so in the grand scheme of evolution, we had a common ancestor relatively recently. Whereas if you look at the sequences of, say, some of the like common yeast infection, Candida albicans, the message that's printed out by the template is 23 base pairs long, whereas ours is only 6, and all mammals are 6. All plants, higher plants are 6. So the message is not important. It's just that you have some message printed out that the adaptation is to have some cap on the end of the chromosome. So the next slide shows that the controls of the TERT gene, which is the reverse transcriptase gene, appears to be highly conserved. Again, the take-home point being that there's a region which is like 75% exactly the same between distantly related mammals and 91% conserved among primates. So the principle being that the longer you have time to evolve, the more things will diverge. If the function stays the same, then the thought is it's an important function. When they specifically looked in 2005 at dogs versus people, they found that you could actually, that the promoter region, which is the area which is the control of the gene expression, is just right, you know, upstream of the actual information part. That's what turns down. That the control of this telomerase reverse transcriptase gene, or the how much of this you put out, seems to be the same between dogs and humans. And again, this is even a more recent study in 2010, showing that you can actually interchange the human telomerase promoter function with dog telomerase function. For all intents and purposes, the same. And finally, I think this point is interesting, that people have been using a mouse model for aging, but mice do not age like people. They have extremely long telomeres, and although the Harvard group of Dana-Farber engineered a mouse to age like people and then reversed it last year, mice were never a good model, but horses and particular dogs do age like people. So this study is saying, although theirs are longer, between 12 and 23,000 base pairs, whereas ours would be between like 4 and 10,000, it suggests that the dog telomere biology is similar to humans and may be a good model for studying telomere biology. There is one study I found about osteosarcoma, which is bone sarcoma or a type of cancer of mesenchymal origin. So they found simply that telomerase activity was 100% in those cells. So, of course, you know, people worry about telomerase activating cancer, making cancer strong, but those cells are already 100% active. It's already on. So it's as though you're throwing matches onto a campfire. It's not going to, you know, appreciably help it. The cell is already immortal. Telomerase activation in the healthy host cells, like the immune system, hopefully will overwhelm those already telomerase positive cells. So this gorgeous creature here is Lulu Reinheimer. This is taken, I think, sometime last year when she had her front limbs intact. And the story really begins mid-December. It was snowy and up in Idaho where they live, Kathy and Lulu, and she was limping for a couple of days. And so, of course, her owner, Kathy, thought that she had slipped on the ice and twisted something, but it didn't go away. She didn't shake it off. So being very concerned with Lulu's health, she took her to the vet. The vet did an exam, did an x-ray, and there was a large white area in the left humerus, or the arm bone. At the time, the chest x-ray appeared clear. So within 12 hours, Lulu had an amputation up to the scapula. The entire arm was removed. And then recovery was complicated by a very dangerous methicillin-resistant staph aureus infection. And a seroma is just a big ball of fluid that can sometimes accumulate at the wound site. So that was kind of hairy for a while, and she had to take some heavy-duty antibiotics to get through that. But eventually, 5 weeks after the amputation, she started chemo. Chemo is of several types, but in this case, it was carboplatin, which has less of a side effect profile than cisplatin, the original, and less than doxorubicin, which they did not use here. So after the first chemo in February, Kathy noted that Lulu was tired, and then she started having some retching with some bilious or bile vomiting. So at that time, she was able to give the dog some anti-nausea pills called Zofran, and Lulu did well with that. Of course, she had suppression of her white blood cells and red blood cells, and that's kind of how they measured next cycle of chemo, which would have come about roughly 4 weeks apart. Right after her first chemo, Kathy had been sent a link to our cancer podcast number one, in which we interviewed Leyla and Jackie, and some of her friends sat down to watch it because they were concerned about another dear friend of theirs who had just been diagnosed with ovarian cancer. Kathy set out to do some research and found that dogs and horses had taken astragalus, and it appeared to be safe. So she thought, well, given the prognosis she was given, this might be something to try. Oh, this just shows the pathology report from December. And again, left proximal humerus osteosarcoma. And that's not good. While taking TA-65, this is pretty typical of what would happen. This is Lulu's blood results from April 7th, where she dropped down to 3,800 white blood cells. And then whilst she was taking TA-65, since mid to end of February, early March, she would bounce back pretty quickly, this one to 11,000. Next up, we have chest x-ray. After the first four cycles, the veterinarian did a chest x-ray to evaluate for lung metastasis. And in May, this did show, I think this is it. I didn't have anywhere to mark it. I'm not a radiologist, but my guess is this was it. It looks like a little, Brazil nut almost there. And because it's visualized not only in the front to back, but in the side to side, that looks like a cancer.